What do you think? Nation states or cats? Who's the bigger threat? We'll decide later.
As soon as something like this happens, we need to put a number of trains in motion in parallel. Like one train obviously is understanding, just like gathering as much data as we possibly can about what's going on. The second is about notifying people. And that's a deep and difficult set of conversations. The third one, and this is where a lot of the folks on my side of the world get deeply involved, is about what are we going to do immediately for impacted customers?
I spent 19 years in the United States military, 3 combat deployments, aviation, logistics, supply, and combat engineering. All of the teams came together in a way that very much reminded me of the way that my Marine Corps came together. And so the way that we respond is like very much like first responders. We pride ourselves on being able to come together regardless of what our areas of specialty are and our areas of expertise, and filling the gaps between each other very quickly on a team that can actually get a mission completed. Just selflessness and the sense of like, if we weren't defending, then who else was going to?
We ended up doing like, you know, trying to really reach out to the customer. We were very fast to try to notify them and really help them with recovery. That actually enabled us to really limit the possibility of the attacker to become more dangerous. They had to fight a little bit more, and usually when they end up facing unplanned actions, that's where the adversary may commit mistakes, right? And mistakes help us to detect. So it's kind of a cycle, so we end up eventually finding little mistakes or actually gathering more evidence that allow us to detect more, right?
We had one customer that refused to believe that we were Microsoft and in fact hung up on our colleague that was making the actual phone call. Just wouldn't even pick up the phone. One of the challenges, of course, when you call a customer to tell them that there's been a problem is that they've been conditioned for years to believe Microsoft's never gonna call you. You really have to meet the customer where they are, because the attack is so significant that they're all going to need help in different sorts of ways. And so that's the cool thing about the size and scope and breadth of Microsoft Response, is that we can pivot and we have the skills that help us meet the customer and the needs that they have.
To see the looks on people's faces as the gravity of that settled in was certainly sobering for me and my team. But also it was a tremendous incentive for us to keep going until we could get to the very bottom of it.
As a product team, we were really invested in helping our customers in hunting for and investigating, looking for indicators of the NOBELIUM attack within their own environments. And so while we weren't front lines at defending Microsoft, we were there to provide the support and the tooling that they needed to do that very hard job.
Threat hunters analyze telemetry to identify indicators, including tactics, techniques, and procedures, or TTPs, the markers of NOBELIUM activity.
So our researchers look at identity, they look at email and collaboration, they look at endpoint, they even look at cloud activity and cloud application security. And by taking a holistic view, we're able to track the attackers who move from domain to domain. And that's usually where they get lost in the noise, in the transitions.
And we had identified over 70 TTPs that we thought these are the body of techniques that you need to understand in order to see this attacker. And we worked to go publish those on our blogs and embody them in the products to speed detection there.
These TTPs are then used to build automated detections for security products to rapidly find and respond to threats.
I pivoted towards taking what we are finding and turning it into these customer-facing detections so that more people can be protected from them. And really, the key aspect of that is taking the patterns of activity we find, determining how generic they are, as in are they specific to a particular customer, or are they a attribute of this threat actor generally, or could it be more broadly scoped than that? And then developing that into logic that fits into our tools.
We were continuously collecting more and more information about how this attack evolves, what are the different pieces, what's new and unique about it, and then working with the different teams of in our products to create new detections and capabilities.
After release into products, these detections help customers automatically find and respond to new threats across their environments.
So what our researchers and we are trying to do with our product is lay it out for our customers so they can see and understand what it was that the attacker did, and also help them remediate and to return their network and their assets to a healthy state.
We've had incidents before where we've needed to rapidly release detection activity or detection material, but never on the scale that we did with NOBELIUM. We were releasing multiple detections a day into the product, and that continued for the best part of 3 weeks.
It wasn't just one detection, like, oh, if we just could find this one thing, that would solve all of our problems. The reality is that, you know, there are a collection of activities that a threat actor takes as they execute against the kill chain. And it is that sort of collection of detections at those various stages using those different tactics and techniques that were linked to NOBELIUM, I think, that really helped organizations to get that end-to-end view of the attack and the scope and the impact of resources so they could respond. But, you know, it seconds count when responding to an attack like this. And so we were able to kind of put things into high gear and expedite that process of getting this content out. And our Microsoft Threat Intelligence team published workbooks and Azure Sentinel notebooks to help our customers to do the same work themselves. So security analysts were able to use Azure Sentinel to hunt for specific TTPs across a broad set of data.
Because the threat actor had compromised several customers' on-premise ADFS servers and stolen key material, people were very keen to protect that. And we got a lot of feedback saying, this is, how do we detect this aspect of it?
All traffic, all work across an enterprise is really based upon our identities and what access those identities have. And so trying to pick out which signal or which behavior is malicious from something that is benign is really difficult in order to create a detection of the attack. We leverage signal from our endpoint sensor on the ADFS server itself, with signal from identity token traffic to and from the ADFS server. If we take a signal of an activity that happens on an endpoint that by itself might even be benign some of the time, we detect an identity, which in its own might also be benign. But we know that those two, when they occur together, are a clear indication of malicious activity. By correlating signal from different sources, we're able to increase the confidence of our detection and actually create an incident in Microsoft 365 Defender that describes the entire attack, kill chain stage by kill stage, from the ADFS server to the cloud, step by step.
So once we managed to create that and publish it, I think that was one that was kind of very impactful for customers, but also quite kind of personally rewarding.
Another thing that they did was they would turn off logging and or antivirus on the systems. And of course that essentially, they attempted to blind the security people so that what they did wouldn't even show up in our logs. But in larger organizations, people often have reasons for turning off logging, whether they're good or bad reasons. The Microsoft Defender for Endpoint team did actually come up with a bunch of new ways and techniques of making sure that their Defender tool doesn't get turned off. Or if it does, it does throw an alert that's noticed somewhere. So they were able to grow their tool based off of the lessons we learned from this.
We're helping customers on their worst days. So really respecting the fact that our customers are having a hard time, they're overwhelmed, they are tired, right? They don't know what to do. Having empathy for that, I think, is really important.
Turning on multi-factor authentication, making sure patches are installed. Those are the basics. They're the diet and exercise of the information technology sector. And we really owe it to ourselves and to our customers to bring that back into the conversation, to make it cool again to talk about hygiene, cyber hygiene, and the basics, because it's too often that nation states don't need advanced, sophisticated tactics like we saw.
Identity is the number one entry and access point for the majority of all of these attacks. And if you can get a handle on identity first, then your journey towards being secure is going to be immensely faster and more efficient.
You have to think about a modern distributed estate. You have to think about how you're going to deploy zero trust. And so what you saw is the attacker traversing a lot of different parts of the estate and bypassing the firewalls altogether. So if you want to protect against that, you actually need a monitoring system that's highly distributed, and you have to have tools that really give you advanced behavioral modeling to help your defenders have more insight. And then the third thing is you have to practice. You have to exercise the whole system, including the humans, including the security teams, including the end users.
You know, when we do our job right, we get to feed information to the customer, we get to feed information back into our products, our products get to take advantage of that, and then the next time, our products do a little bit better, we do a little bit better, we find a new attack, we rinse and repeat, and this is a cycle that continually goes on every single day.